Well, it is good to be home in the South, and I'm delighted. And we have real ties here because my younger daughter went to Presbyterian, and her husband's grandfather was the state dairyman. Her father-in-law was Strom Thurmond's first chief of staff in the U.S. Senate. And Jimmy Cushman has many, many fond ties and relatives across the state, so we're thrilled to be here. I want to do something a little bit different for a second. This is a little bit like in church. I want to ask if all of the young people who are here would like to come up for a second. Come on up. Come on. Everybody, all the young people. Okay, there are a few more of them than I realized. But let me tell you why I wanted to do this, and I appreciate them coming up, and I appreciate their parents letting them come up. I'm frankly pretty fed up with the whole tone of American politics and American government. These young people are what this campaign should be all about. It is their country. It is their future. Okay, I'll concede the baby in your arms is too young to come up. But when I come here for re-election, you can bring the baby up, okay? Thank you all. Do you like being up here? Do you want to stay up here? Is this okay to be up here? Okay. All right. Some of them are very shy and some of them aren't very shy at all. But let me tell you why I wanted to do this for a minute. And if you guys do get bored, you can go back, but you can stay here. Oh, thank you. Can I look at it? This is very important. What's your dog's name? Bubbles. This is Bubbles? Okay, this is also about Bubbles' future. There you are. But I really have been trying for the last month and a half to figure out how to communicate clearly what is at stake. I think this is the most important election in our lifetime. And I don't think it's just important because we need to somehow beat Barack Obama, although that's very, very important. But beating him isn't enough. You have a bipartisan establishment that has been running this country, that has created a gigantic mess. You have bureaucracies that are out of control, judges who think they can be dictators. You have systems around this country. You have laws that don't work. So we've got to change not just Obama, but we have to change the entire direction of the United States of America to get it back on track, and that is our obligation to these young people. So I've been at this since my dad was stationed in the Army in Orléans, France in 1958. So I spent 53 years trying to understand what we need. And I'm going to share that with you. You all can go back to your parents now. But thank you for coming up. You and Bubbles can go back too. Thank you all very much. Okay. But doesn't that put a face on it? This is about the country, our children and grandchildren. As you know, Clissa and I have two grandchildren, Maggie, who's 12, and Robert, who's 10. They're my primary debate coaches. And, you know, that's why we're running. We're running because I'm really worried about the America they're going to inherit. I'm worried that the disastrous policies that we now have in our establishment are so profoundly wrong. And I'll tell you one of the places that really helped me crystallize this in the last week. We had a debate the other night. And folks were going on and on and on, you know, in the media about gay rights and this and that and, you know, plus a brief 15-minute excursion on contraception, which I thought was really, truly bizarre. I mean, I don't know about y'all, but in terms of the presidency of the United States and the crises we're faced with, that had to rank like number 682 on the list. So after I listened to all this baloney for a while, I just broke in and said, look, the challenge we have is anti-Christian bigotry that has forced the Catholic Church to close its adoption service in Massachusetts because it actually wanted to follow the tenets of Christianity. And you look all around this country, and you see again and again, whether it's a judge knocking down a cross, whether it is Judge Barry in San Antonio, who on June 1st said, not only can students not pray, but if they use the word God, if they use the word benediction, if they use the word invocation, if they ask the audience to stand, if they ask for a moment of silence, I will put the superintendent of school in jail. And I thought to myself, what have we come to? When a country founded on a belief that we are endowed by our Creator turns around and has judges who say, if you even use the word benediction, I'll put you in jail. If I am your president, if you will help me win this election, we will not tolerate a speech dictatorship in this country against Christianity. So let's be clear. You know, what really struck me was the following 2 days, people kept randomly walking up to me and saying thank you that somebody finally spoke out. And I thought about how does this whole thing work? And I've been through the last couple of days a very similar thing where if you speak out, every effort is made to distort and confuse what you're saying because what you're saying may be so frightening to the establishment. So I want to spend a few minutes with you here telling you the truth about where we are as I understand it and the truth about the kind of president we need to get out of this mess. And I'll let you decide whether this is where you want America to go and whether you're willing to help in the next 10 days get there. This primary is the crossroads for this country. We have to nominate someone capable of standing up and telling the truth against Barack Obama because you're not going to beat a billion-dollar machine of dishonesty with somebody who's inarticulate or confused or doesn't quite know what they stand for. We have to have a leader who is prepared to go nose-to-nose in a series of debates and tell the truth about the president who is a Saul Alinsky radical seeking to profoundly change the United States of America. I am prepared to challenge the president to 7 3-hour debates in the Lincoln-Douglas tradition with a timekeeper but no moderator. And I am prepared to allow the president to use a teleprompter as part of that. And I'll tell you the truth. I believe I can tell the truth better without a teleprompter, that he can fake it with a teleprompter. And we're going to have a clear campaign of choice that's about this wide. On the one side, you're going to have somebody who believes in the Declaration of Independence, the Constitution of the United States, the Federalist Papers, and the lessons of American history. On the other side, you're going to have a Saul Alinsky radical who has done just about as much to wreck this country as any president in the history of the United States. And I am prepared to follow him every day by 4 hours wherever he goes and answer his speeches every single day until he agrees to the debates because he ain't going to be able to run, he ain't going to be able to hide, and the $1 billion isn't going to cover up how bad his campaign is. Now, let me give you a couple of examples. Let's imagine we were having the debate here this morning. I would say to him, how could you possibly have illegally appointed a National Labor Relations Board for the purpose of killing jobs in South Carolina? And I call on the Republican House to defund the National Labor Relations Board until he gets rid of the illegal appointments that he has made. I will also tell you, the very first day I am president, I will instruct the Attorney General to drop the lawsuit against South Carolina and every other state on the issue of immigration. It is the job of the federal government to enforce the law and protect America, not to attack the states who are trying to do the job the federal government refuses to do. Let me also say, on the very first day, I will instruct the Attorney General to drop any lawsuit about voter identification. What does it tell you about the Obama administration that they are afraid to have an honest election? They are afraid if we only allow legal voters. Now, I know they're from Chicago. I know there's a long residual tradition of voting for three generations. But it's wrong. Every American should have the right to vote, and every American should have the right to make sure that their vote isn't canceled by somebody who is illegal or dead or in some other way shouldn't be voting. We are faced with huge choices. And I believe the American people have the right to know about the last 3 or 4 years. And this is, I'm amazed how we've gone through this total mess. And the establishment in Washington, New York just keeps trying to cover it up. The Federal Reserve has poured trillions of dollars out with no supervision, no accountability, no reports. You and I, the people who have provided the money, have no idea who got it and who didn't, why they got it, why they didn't. One of the first things I will insist on is a complete and total audit of the Federal Reserve to put out every single thing. And I want them to publish every decision document for 2008, 2009, and 2010. We deserve to know when Bernanke, sitting in some closed room with a bunch of gigantic banks, who got money and who didn't. I mean, the scale of potential corruption when you have trillions of dollars. And let me say, this is bipartisan. The initial wave of money came out under the Bush administration when you had a Goldman Sachs Secretary of the Treasury and a Goldman Sachs Chief of Staff and a Goldman Sachs Deputy in charge of the bailout. And oh, by the way, when AIG got lots of money, $13 billion of it happened to go to Goldman Sachs. Now, I don't know about you. I think $13 billion is a lot of money. And I'd like to know, how did they make the decision? They didn't bail out a small bank in South Carolina. They didn't bail out all the folks whose homes were in trouble. They didn't take care of anybody who had a mortgage problem. But boy, if you were big enough, they couldn't add enough zeros to the check. And I just think nobody's had the courage to talk about this because it infuriates the establishment. And I want to make something clear because this has been going on for the last 3 days. Criticizing specific actions in specific places is not being anti-free enterprise. And crony capitalism, where people pay each other off at the expense of the rest of the country, is not free enterprise. And raising questions about that is not wrong. I'm going to go a step further. Given the scale of the mess we're now in, given the trillions of dollars that have been poured around the planet, we owe it to these young people. These are the folks that the current generation of politicians expect to pay everything off. They are irresponsibly piling up debt, and it's much bigger than just the deficit of the government. It's all the money that the Federal Reserve is pouring out. Well, I think we have an obligation as parents and grandparents to protect these children from the kind of politicians and the kind of insiders who want to take away their future in order to prop up the present for people who don't deserve it. And I am committed to stopping. Let me say a couple other things that I think need to be said that don't make the establishment very happy. We can get to a balanced budget pretty darn fast if we have courage. I was in New Hampshire, and Speaker O'Brien adopted a remarkable procedure I recommend to every state and to the federal government. He actually had the Ways and Means Committee report first, and they said, here's how much money we're going to have this year. And he then said, we can pass any budget which fits the amount of money we're going to have. They cut 11% out of the state budget to get to a balanced budget. Normally what states do is they produce a budget, decide that they're short money, and they come to your wallet. And they say, gee, I need the money more than you need the money. And so they find some way to raise taxes. My entire career has been spent fighting for lower taxes to create more jobs, to have a smaller government, and to balance the budget. And I am the only candidate in this race in either party who has actually helped balance the budget for four consecutive years and paid off $405 billion in debt. And I believe, with your help, that we can get Washington back in balance within 4 or 5 years. We can get economic growth explosive. I believe the economy is going to start growing late on election night when it's clear that Obama is going home. Now, let me also say something that again makes our establishment in our own party nervous. We need, and South Carolina is going to be decisive about this, we need a conservative nominee to beat Barack Obama, because we need someone who stands for the principles of the American people. Ronald Reagan said it best at the very depths of the Republican Party's collapse after Watergate, at the very first CPAC meeting, or I guess the second CPAC session ever held, when he said, we need bold colors, not pale pastels. Well, let me tell you, I don't believe any moderate can debate Barack Obama successfully because there's not a big enough gap between the two of them. And I believe if you're going to defeat Barack Obama, you are only going to defeat him with a conservative. And that requires South Carolinians to come together, because I believe I am the only conservative who can actually carry a record of achievement into that debate and who can actually stand toe-to-toe with Obama. But I do not believe that we can defeat Obama if we have somebody who's either inarticulate, moderate, or has no record of achievement. I mean, if you're going to compete with a president who's happy to say anything, you had better have a factual basis around which to debate him, because, you know, Lincoln once said, if a man won't agree that 2 + 2 = 4, you'll never win the argument, because facts make no difference. Now, I don't actually expect Obama to agree that 2 + 2 = 4, but I expect the American people to watch the debate and figure out that 2 + 2 = 4. And I think the more we debate, the clearer it gets, the bigger our margin's going to be, so we can win the House, the Senate, and the White House, and have a wave of change in Washington. Let me also say, this goes back to this whole right to know and the whole way our current establishment operates. We need a completely new dialogue about the Middle East. First of all, let me go back to my initial point about anti-Christianity. When we entered Iraq in 2003, there were 1,200,000 Christians. Today, there are 500,000. I don't regard persecution, violence, intimidation that drives 500,000+ Christians out of a country as an American success. I think it is an embarrassing failure to stand up for the right of freedom of religion and to stand up for the values of our civilization. In Egypt, Coptic Christian churches, 2,000 years old, are being burned. In Nigeria, Christians are being killed. We need a foreign policy which understands that we do represent a civilization. I disagree deeply with the president on this. I think he's totally confused about what's going on. I don't think you can negotiate with the Taliban. I don't think you can negotiate with Hezbollah and Hamas. I don't think you can negotiate with people who want to kill you. And I disagree with some of my friends in this race. I believe an Iranian nuclear weapon is a terrifying possibility because I believe the Iranians will use it. You know, when a radical Islamist, to use a term that this administration has outlawed, they won't even tell us the truth about who's trying to kill us. They can't even use the words. When a radical Islamist puts on a bomb, walks into a grocery store or a mall or gets on a bus, and blows himself up for the purpose of killing us, why would anyone think they would have anything but joy at being able to put on a nuclear bomb to kill many of us? And if you remember how you felt on 9/11 when we lost 3,100 people to an attack by terrorists in our own soil, on our own country, imagine the impact of losing a city. This isn't scare talk. This is objective, practical reality. The time to stop this kind of threat is before it gets a nuclear weapon, not after it uses a nuclear weapon. And that requires a great national debate. We, the people, have got to decide, are we prepared to defend ourselves and defend our cities, and are we prepared to render judgment? And it is a judgment. It's a judgment that says, you know, the Iranian leadership as it is today is a threat to our very survival, and therefore we want to use exactly the techniques that Ronald Reagan, Margaret Thatcher, and Pope John Paul II used. They spent 8 years defeating the Soviet Empire without a major war. We should replace the Iranian dictatorship with people willing to live in peace with us, and we should never tolerate the Iranian dictatorship getting a nuclear weapon, period. Let me just say two things that relate directly to South Carolina and to how wrong this president is. When you think about the Middle East and you think about the dangers and you watch the Iranians practice closing the Straits of Hormuz, where one out of every six barrels of oil go through, you have to ask yourself the following question. Why do we not have an American energy policy to make this irrelevant? When I debate President Obama, I'm going to say to him directly, how could you stop the development of natural gas off of South Carolina, killing jobs in South Carolina, while you go to Brazil to tell the Brazilians how proud you are that they're developing oil and gas offshore, and how glad you are that we loaned $2 billion to cover purchasing equipment from a company owned by George Soros. And how could you possibly go, Mr. President, and say, I want America to be your best customer? You know, Obamanomics is to borrow from the Chinese to pay the Brazilians. It doesn't work. And what I would say is, I will be America's best salesman around the world. I will not be a purchasing agent for foreign powers. And that's how big the difference is. Now, let me explain why this is so central to South Carolina. You have at least $29 billion of natural gas offshore. If we did it right, we could be developing that natural gas, which would be worth, the average job offshore in Louisiana is $80,000 a year. So you'd be developing an entire industry offshore. You can put it far enough offshore, it doesn't affect tourism at all. And as you develop it, you get good jobs. But also, if we agreed to a split in the royalties, the new energy could then pay for modernizing the port of Charleston so we could accept the ships that are going to come through the Panama Canal in 2014. The Boston Consulting Group has done a study, and they say manufacturing in South Carolina taking total cost will be less expensive than manufacturing in Shanghai by 2015. If we had leadership, we could create a generation of manufacturing to export to the world market through the port of Charleston with the kind of president who'd actually go around and sell American products instead of buying Brazilian products. And you would then have jobs in South Carolina, not jobs in Brazil, and you'd have people happy because America only works when Americans are working. Let me say one last thing, and then I'm going to take questions. But I really wanted to talk from the heart, and I wanted to talk on behalf of these young people. There is enormous pressure in the establishment, in both parties, to not bring up things. Don't bring up the anti-religious bias. Don't bring up the fact that this rule is going to have an effect on every single faith-based health institution in the country. Don't talk about who got all the money. Don't raise the questions of looking at all the decisions. Can't we just move forward letting the rich keep all the money and not really ask any question about how did it get taken out? I want you to know that I am running precisely because as an Army brat from a middle-class family who taught in a college, I think middle-class, tax-paying, working Americans deserve to have a government that is honest, a government that tells them the truth, and I believe you have the right to know and you have the right to speak out, and I am prepared to stand up to every level of pressure. And I think, frankly, if you're going to have a free enterprise system, it can't have crony capitalism. If you're going to have a free enterprise system, it can't have secret deals in Washington. If you're going to have crony capitalism, it can't destroy small banks in South Carolina on behalf of giant banks in New York and then turn to and say, oh, gosh, I don't know what happened. Gee, that's unfortunate. And so I want you to know, the very first day the Congress comes in 2013, as your president, I'm going to demand that they pass three changes and not go home, but stay and get them done before the inaugural so I can sign them the minute I'm sworn in. I want them first to repeal Obamacare because it is destroying jobs. I want them, second, to repeal the Dodd-Frank bill, which is killing small banks, and is set, the Dodd-Frank bill is creating a center of corruption in the Treasury, which has an ability to micromanage the big banks. And since 2008, the banks that are too big to fail have gotten bigger, and the banks that were small enough to deal with you and me have gotten smaller. That is exactly the wrong direction, and I want the Congress to repeal Dodd-Frank immediately upon getting them sworn in. And finally, I want them in early January to repeal Sarbanes-Oxley, which is a paperwork bill that cripples business and produces no new information. And here's why I need you. We're not going to get this done unless you are with us, you know, I never ask an audience to be for me. Because if you're for me, you're going to vote, go home and say, I sure hope Newt fixes it. I ask you to be with me so that together, side by side, I'm going to need your help convincing the Congress we're serious. I'm going to need, and the time to convince them, by the way, is before they get reelected. They pay much more attention in September and October. They make many more commitments when they want your vote. And so we need to run a campaign that isn't just the presidential campaign. This is a campaign to take on the establishment in both parties. This is a campaign to say we are ready to truly, fundamentally change Washington, and it's going to require the courage and the discipline and the commitment of the American people, not just the president, the American people. But if you will help, I will insist on the truth. I want a free enterprise system that is honest. I want a free enterprise system that's accountable. I want a free enterprise system that is fair to everyone and gives everyone an equal opportunity to pursue happiness. And I think it's central to our future to reestablish the work ethic and to have people understand that together we can create a dramatically more prosperous future. Thank you.